So today we're going to talk about how to battle fear and anxiety, because depression is usually linked with fear and anxiety also. And people who suffer from fear and anxiety also suffer from depression. So there's a innate link between the feeling of fear and anxiety as well as depression. So it's important. I mean, we keep talking about depression a lot, but we don't talk about fear and anxiety, because that's something that's we think as separate, but it's not separate actually. It's part of the whole gamut of mental illness. So the reason why we fear is because there's some doubt in our mind about something or the other, right? Because we don't know about certain things. We don't know the truth about certain things, and we try and imagine it to be something else. And that's the reason why we start having fear in our minds. There's much more deeper reasons for fear. We'll cover that as we go along. But this is just to give you an inkling of where it starts from. It starts from doubt. It starts from the fact that you don't have enough knowledge about a certain aspect. Or even if you know about it, you're not believing in it. So the fear comes into play because of that. So fear has two meanings: forget everything and run, or face everything and rise.
False evidence appearing real.
Absolutely. False evidence appearing real. That's also a definition of fear. So the choice is yours. Ultimately, what we need to realize is our minds are our minds. No one else can control it for you. Only you can control it for yourself. A head full of fears has no space for dreams. So what is the exact definition of fear? A distressing emotion aroused by impending danger, evil, pain, etc. Whether the threat is real or imagined, the feeling or condition of being afraid. So there's foreboding, apprehension, consternation, dismay, dread, terror, fright, panic, horror, trepidation, calm, courage, antonyms are, that's the opposite of fear. That's courage, security, calm, and intrepidity. Anxiety is a feeling of apprehension, uneasiness, uncertainty, or dread resulting from real or perceived threat whose actual source is unknown or unrecognized. So fear is a reaction to specific danger, like Shreyas just mentioned. Similarity between anxiety and fear: physiological response to those experiences is the same, basically. So the fight or flight response is what we're talking about when we're talking about physiological responses. What you choose today will determine who you are tomorrow. That's spoken by Tim Fargo. This is just to give you an idea of how our memory works. It's a cycle, basically. So you have sensory input, which goes to your, so it goes through your ear or eyes, and then you become consciously aware of what's happening, and then it goes into your memory, right? So don't lose yourself in fear. The escalation of fear, patterns of fight, flight, freeze, and fake. So it's when the fear starts, sets in, it's usually fright, horror, terror, etc. The next stage is the flight, where you're fleeing neurotic obsession or addictions. The next stage is fight. Right? You'll try and fight also, because that's part of your response. That's part of your inherent response. So that's blaming and arguing. So that's one way of fighting. Freeze is basically fainting and paranoia. When you're freezing, when you're face to face with a stressor, which is beyond your capability of dealing with, then you either freeze, you fight, or you flight. Fake is justifying your response, justifying what is happening. The fear thermometer goes from not anxious at all to very anxious. So going So this is for kids, basically, walking home from school alone. So if you look at the fears that kids experience, going out on a playground at recess, there is some anxiety involved in that also. And even walking home from school or returning from school. So stress works on your body and mind, and it is affected in your behavior and emotions, right? So when stress affects your body, you usually get headaches, frequent infections, taut muscles feel tight, muscular switches, fatigue, skin irritations, breathlessness are what you experience when you have stress in your body. Where your mind is concerned, you start feeling worried, you start think in a muddled manner, impaired judgment, nightmares, indecisions, negativity, and hasty decision making. Where your emotions are concerned, it's loss of confidence, you feel more fussy, you become more irritable, you feel depressed, you feel an apathy, you feel apprehension, and you feel alienation. Yeah. And if where your behavior is concerned, it's accident, you become accident prone,
risky
behavior, loss of appetite, loss of sex drive, drinking more, insomnia, restlessness, and smoking more. So basically it results in your habits changing, right, towards more extreme behavior.
If stress is a phasic phenomenon,
Yeah, sure.
If stress is a phasic phenomena, then these things you mentioned occur. If it's a phasic phenomena to a normal person of able body and sound mind, and these very phenomena occurs also to a person who is diagnosed with a clinical depression or a mental illness. So how to juxtapose?
See, when it's a phasic phenomena, what happens? It's phased, right? It's phased. It's not continuous.
No, but the response and the reaction to the stress is same.
That's fine. No, I mean that's your normal response. Your response to stress is normal. It's your inherent response. It's not something that comes from outside. So that's fine. As long as you're responding to it in a more constructive manner, it's fine. It's when you're not able to respond to it in a constructive manner that it becomes an illness.
Some kind of a nervous breakdown means it is a cause for worry.
Yeah, it's a cause for worry, and it leads to an illness then. Then you might have some kind of illness on being onset at that point.
And if it's a normal person who's going through a episode of stress, there is a need for expert intervention.
There's no need, as long as that person is willing to take care of himself or herself. I mean, if that stress continues for over a period of time, then it can deteriorate into an illness. See, what you're doing is you're putting pressure on your body systems, right? When you're constantly living a stressful life over a period of time, over a longer period of time, you're constantly putting your body to test, right? And you're putting your body at risk. Body and mind. When I say body, it means body and mind. So when you're putting your body and mind at risk, at some point your mind is going to snap, right? Your body is going to snap and your mind is going to snap. And that's when you start experiencing illness. So this is the fear and avoidance cycle. So you have anxiety in any form. That's anxiety is either triggered in reaction to an event or thought, idea or sensation. Or non-triggered, that means it happens out of the blue, okay? Then you have a fear of consequences. That's specific feared or dreaded consequences or thought about the situation. I will lose, like the fear of losing control over the situation. That's something that sits in your mind. I'm having a heart attack. Like you might not be having a heart attack, you're just having a panic situation. But you might think you're having a heart attack because that fear sets in your mind. The people don't like me. I mean, because you're so complex about yourself, you start thinking that other people don't like you. I'm stupid and make a fool of myself. So these are the thoughts negative image about yourself, the negative thoughts that accumulate in your brain when you start fearing and when you start having anxiety.
Is it lasting in nature or how is it?
See, if it goes on for a longer period of time, obviously it is something. Lasting. Yeah, then it becomes an illness. Like I said earlier, it's an illness and you need to treat it. then it's pathological. So you need to treat it. Anticipatory anxiety, thinking about situations ahead of time. So then you also start thinking about, so this is a cycle that you're experiencing. You start from the anxiety, the start of the onset of the anxiety, you start fearing consequences, then you start anticipating things beforehand, you know, negative things that happen. Yeah, then you start getting that paranoia starts setting in. Then there's actual avoidance, then you start avoiding those situations because you think that that's happening to you. That's going to happen to you, so I'm going to avoid that.
Avoidance.
Yeah, so then that avoidance starts happening. Yeah, and then the reinforce, then again you're reinforcing the fear all over again, because by avoiding the situation, you're telling yourself that situation is going to be harmful for you, so you need to stay away from that situation. So you're basically isolating yourself from the people around you and the society around you. So that affects your mind much more. Because every human being needs to interact, needs to communicate, needs.
Irrational defense mechanism.
Yeah, it's a defense mechanism, obviously, but it's not healthy. I won't say irrational. I'll say it's not healthy. It's not healthy for a human being to be that in that state of mind. To escape fear, you have to go through it, not around it. So this is a very telling statement. I mean, everyone tries to escape fear by not doing the things that they think will harm them. Yeah, so you need to go through it to be able to come out of that fear psychosis. How to escape the grip of fear? So this is just an exercise that you can do. When you are caught in fear, anxiety or a phobia, tapping a point on the triple warmer meridian which governs a fight or flight response can alleviate the fear.
Phobia is inherent, right? I mean, how can you rid yourself of
it? No, phobia is something that happen with you develop over time, right? It's nothing is ingrained. You it's a conditioning that happens over time. So when you are a child, people around you say, okay, cockroaches are harmful, or you know that those messages are coming at you all the time. Suppose your parent is someone who's scared of cockroaches, so that gets passed on to the child because the parent is behaving in such a illogical manner over some kind of stimuli, right? Whatever it might be a roach, it might be a rat, it might be something or something else, something that happened. So that kind of conditioning develops over time and that develops into a phobia because that stops the person from living his life fully, his or her life to the full extent. That's why it's called a phobia. If it's just a fear, it's not a phobia. This fear can always be tackled, but when it becomes a phobia, then it becomes even more difficult to tackle it because then it becomes set in your mind, becomes ingrained in you. So start tapping on the backside of your hand halfway between your wrist and your fingers. Okay, yeah, that's the place. Aligned with the point where your fourth and fifth fingers converge. Tap for about a minute. Just tap, smooth, soft taps. If you still feel fear, tap on the other hand. Even for a long-standing phobia, repeatedly using this technique begins to alter the underlying energetic pattern. So basically what it's really trying to do is sending a signal to your mind that is not what you need to worry about. That's the basic understanding of. So you're sending a contrary signal to the mind saying that this is not something that needs to be worried about, or this is not something that needs to be given too much importance on. Do the thing you fear to do and keep on doing it. That is the quickest and surest way of ever yet discovered to conquer fear.
What an irony he's saying.
Yeah, Dale Carnegie. Yeah, but he committed suicide, so obviously he is. But a lot of people who are wise have contradicted themselves by
Vincent Van Gogh.
Yeah, so they all do these things. I mean, ultimately they come to a point.
Nirvana.
Singer Kurt Cobain.
27.
Yeah. So basically, ultimately we must realize that we are all human beings, right? And we are susceptible to stimuli. whether internal or external.
His books inspired so many people, and he killed
Yeah. He must have come to a point where he thought life was not worth living. So, yeah. So it's that's the sadness, sad thing about
the irony
of living. Yeah. So we were talking about the fight and flight mechanism. So when you either have you either fight or you flight or you run away, right? So you when you fight, you stand your ground, you defend your position. You attack, you dig in, or get severe. And when you flight, that's when you run away. You give way, you retreat, you discard, you remove yourself, give up, or move on. Right? In a stressful situation, like some co-worker is accusing you of spilling company secrets, you fight, that is, you say something back. Or you run away, flight, that is physically leave the area, or you freeze, or you don't say anything and hope that the person will leave, right? So these are the
never confront.
Yeah. So these are the ways you behave. That's your normal response, right? And you choose either of these three, or you might choose it in succession or whatever, whichever way you feel comfortable handling it. So, where in the brain is the fear processed? You can see the blue area. That's exactly where. I'll show you the yeah. That's the back of the brain. Yeah. So the thalamus, basically. Yeah. So that's somewhere situated in the back of your neck, na? It's between your the base of your base of the brain. So the sensory cortex. It goes to the thalamus, hypothalamus, amygdala, and hippocampus. Those are the areas basically. The blue and the that's where the processing happens.
The vulnerable areas.
The vulnerable areas. Yeah. It's time for so the neural pathway of fear begins with sensory data. Stepping into the stage, seeing the bright lights, hearing the noise of back. Suppose you're standing in front of an audience on a stage. So it starts when you step onto the stage, you see the bright lights, you hear the noise of a packed house, and that sensory data is gathered and relayed through the brainstem to the thalamus, which is essentially a giant switchboard that directs information to other parts of the brain. From there, it goes to the hippocampus. Sensory cortex and amygdala, areas of the brain that establish situational, emotional context and officially deem the situation as fearful. From there, it goes to the hypothalamus where the fight or flight response is activated. The messages are sent to the kidneys, adrenal glands, which release stress hormones, right? And then it results in behavioral changes, which is through the frontal and the temporal lobes, the higher cortical areas where experience of dread occur, release chemicals like dreaming that can cause panicked irrational behavior, right? So again, this is another representation. This is a kind of flow chart, just to give you an idea. So the messages go to the hypothalamus, and then from there it either goes to the adrenal cortical system or it goes to sympathetic nervous system. And basically the chemicals that are released are the norepinephrine and epinephrine, yeah. At the adrenal cortex, approximately 30 hormones are released.
In post-trauma disorder, the predominant symptoms are fear and anxiety?
Yeah. It's a panic attack, no, basically. So the neural activity combines with hormones in the bloodstream to constitute the fight and flight response. So. It's interlinked. Everything is interlinked in your brain. The physiology of fight and fight or flight, what we know is happening, we have tunnel vision, we have a dry mouth, muscle tension, tightness in the chest, sweating, nausea, diarrhea, and you feel the need to urinate. You feel dizzy or lightheaded, can't concentrate or focus. You feel a burning sensation, difficulty in breathing, difficulty in swallowing. You can feel your heart pounding, butterflies in the stomach, and trembling.
What about suicide ideation?
That's the extreme end of the flight response. So this is again another representation of the same thing. There are much more elements in this. So the noticeable effects and the hidden effects. So when you're talking about noticeable effects are the same that we mentioned earlier, like the pupils dilate, mouth goes dry, neck and shoulder muscles become tense, heart pumps faster, you feel chest pains, you feel palpitations, you start sweating, muscles get tense for action, breathing gets fast and sometimes shallow, hyperventilation, oxygen needed for muscles. And the hidden effects are basically that the brain gets body ready for action. Adrenaline gets released for fight or flight. So adrenaline is required for both responses. Like if you need adrenaline to fight or to flight. Blood pressure rises, liver releases glucose to provide energy for the muscles. Digestion slows or ceases. Sphincters close then relax. Cortisol released depresses the immune system. So this is a pictorial representation of the fight or flight response. One person is attacking and the other person is fleeing. So now we come to anxiety. We spoke about fear earlier, so that fear over a, like we said, that's a cycle that happens. When you constantly have fear, you start, it leads to anxiety through that avoidance, fear and avoidance. We spoke about avoidance. When that fear happens, then you start avoiding. And then again, it increases the fear, you start obstructing your life patterns, and then it leads to a greater amount of anxiety. So the feeling where you stay up at night, stare at your ceiling, ask yourself an infinite number of questions, then sit there and debate on whether or not you actually want to know the answer. The feeling where you wonder who truly cares about you and who's just using you, who's there for you and who's desperately waiting for you to fail. The feeling where you feel like you're not good enough, that you need to be this, this and this to be successful and liked. You crave for attention you know you can't have. The feeling where you get frustrated because it's physically impossible to be 100% happy. You want someone to vent to, but no one will understand you. The feeling where you question your voice, your value, your worth, your pride, yourself and everything. And you think, overthink basically. You start overthinking a lot. All night, all you're left with is you, yourself, and a very dark place. So basically, it's a very lonely space when you're suffering from anxiety, because it's only about you. Everything is about you and what you're going through and what you're feeling about other people and what you think about others and why you think about that. And then it just piles on and it increases. It results in a physical manifestation. So this is the brain and anxiety. So like we spoke earlier, the adrenaline increases, the cortisol increases, insulin increases, thyroid hormones increase when there's a anxiety stimuli. This is a depiction of the communication between the brain hemispheres. You can see that? You can read it? Yeah. So just to give you an understanding of how the brain functions. So this is the cycle of anxiety. So you have negative thoughts, it transforms into behaviors, it affects your learning and coping, and then you have more anxiety and it leads to physical reactions, right? So where children are concerned, they become distracted by physical reactions and negative thoughts and behaviors. As a result, there is decreased learning and coping and more anxiety if the avoidance continues, right? So there's a trigger. That trigger leads to negative or fearful thoughts, leading to anxiety or panic response, leading to beliefs are formed and perpetuate the cycle. So the cycle gets perpetuated again. And the internal or external triggers start the cycle all over again. Like I said earlier when we began, fear, anxiety are linked to depression. And it affects a lot of people. Children with anxiety disorders are least likely to receive treatment. That's because people don't recognize it as a problem area. And a lot of parents palm it off saying that it's just stubborn, the child is just being stubborn or just being, you know, adamant. And
the child is not in a position to communicate.
Absolutely, yeah. So the child finds it difficult to communicate whatever he or she is feeling, and because of which it gets neglected. And that leads on to an adult. When the child becomes an adult, he continues in the same pattern. It's because it's not been dealt with at that point of time, and it should have been. When I continually think I'm depressed, I'm bound to be depressed. Yeah. So how do you win the battle over fear and anxiety? That's the main crux of it, right? So use your social fluency to turn the fight or flight response into the right response. So when we say social fluency, what do we mean by that?
Interpersonal relationship.
Absolutely, the interpersonal relationship. So what you do with your communication skills, right? You how you communicate it out to the other person, how you use it, you use it to. Hi.
Sometimes you figure it with yourself.
Yeah. How you use it to analyze your own behavior and your own cognitive abilities. So you can rewire the brain, okay? Previously, scientists thought that the brain structure was hardwired and immutable. Brain damaged patients rarely made full recoveries, and the living brain's microscopic activities were unobservable. The widely held belief was that the brain was a machine. Machines are capable of many things, but they do not change and grow. That's what was thought of at one point of time. Yeah. But new research has taught us that the brain is actually plastic. It is able to change based on experiences. Even in old age, the adult brain retains neuroplasticity and is able to change its structure and function. It turns out you can teach an old dog new tricks. So now, a lot of times when they publish articles about the brain, they show the differences, the changes that are happening in the brain whenever there's an external stimuli or whenever there's...
After certain age, you know, there's a brain, you know, see shrinking.
Yeah, it all depends on how you utilize your brain. I mean, it's not necessary that it has to shrink.
It works all the
time. It works, but it works.
It does shrink, but there is a large reserve.
Yeah. Six steps to rewire your brain. Engage, feel, imagine, repeat, extend, reason.
Engage. To start with reason.
Yeah. So you reason, you engage, you feel, you imagine, you repeat, you extend, you reason. So it goes back. It's a cycle. So
reason is always the foremost.
Yeah. Done? So how do you fight fear by facing fear? There's a stepladder approach. So it's gradual. You gradually need to stay in step close long enough until the anxiety decreases. Use coping strategies and need to repeat those steps. Basically, there's a reward kind of approach. Suppose if a psychologist or a counselor is trying to get someone to deal with a fear, they offer rewards for every step that has been covered or successfully covered. So that the person has a motivation to achieve that goal at that particular time. So the steps can be anything. We'll talk about the steps. So this is just the approach that we're talking about. The step ladder approach. You need to think flexibly, right? So Albert Ellis, who was the founder of rational emotive behavior therapy, one of the first cognitive behavioral therapies, places demands at the very heart of emotional problems, right? Thoughts and beliefs that contain words like must, should, need, ought, got to, and have to are often problematic because they're extreme and rigid. So you need to change the way you think. You shouldn't be using those words like must, ought, need, got to, have to. You know, you're putting pressure on yourself by doing that. The inflexibility of demands you place on yourself, the world around you, and other people often means you don't adapt to reality as well as you could. Consider these possible examples. You believe that you must have the approval of your friends and colleagues. This leads you to feel anxious in many social situations and drives you to try and win everyone's approval. It's not possible, right? You're never going to have everyone's approval, how much ever you try. You think that because you try very hard to be kind and considerate to others, they really ought to be just as kind and considerate in return. I mean, we have that problem all the time when we get calls on the phone. I've been giving, I've been doing so much for my friend, but that person doesn't do enough for me. I mean, I feel that I've wasted my time. But your friendship should not be because you think that person has to respond in the same manner that you're responding. That person can respond in whatever way they feel comfortable to respond in, right? I mean, your friendship is not determined by what you're getting back in return. It's what you want to do, right? You're doing what you want to do, not because the other person is asking you to do it. So because your demand is not realistic, so it's not other people, you're expecting other people to be governed by that, which is not possible. It's not practical and not idealist also. So you need to set goals for yourself. So you need to unpair feared stimuli. That's any kind of trigger that leads to your fear anxiety response. You need to unpair it, as in remove yourself from that. So you can have the dark can be your trigger. The streets can be your trigger. For women, it might be men, like how it happened on New Year's Eve in Bangalore, where they were groped. So that can be a fear anxiety response. Now, wherever they go in a crowded place, those women who have been attacked at that point of time will feel that fear and anxiety coming up again and again in their lives. Yeah. So they need to get into those positions and try and unpair those fears from that link-ups. You know, that link-up has to be broken. You need to break that link between the dark street or the crowded street and your being there at that point of time. So there's a training called a stress inoculation training where you need to train yourself to deal with stress, to prevent stress from happening. So what that training basically does is gain a better understanding of the nature and effects of stress on performance. You gain new skills and rehearse them so that you become more productive and apply those skills to increasingly stressful situations so that you don't feel those stresses as much, because those add-on skills help you reduce that stress. So when you are in an anxious situation, how to calm yourself down? Find a safe place. Sit down and close your eyes. slowly breathe in and out in a comfortable rhythm. Make sure you're not chest breathing, but expanding and contracting your abdomen. So the breathing technique has to start from the, so you're breathing in, it has to go all the way to your abdomen, and it has to come out from your abdomen, right? The breath has, the exhalation has to start from the bottom of your abdomen, yeah. So it has to be deep enough for that. Begin to watch your breathing in and out. Breathe in for a comfortable count. So basically, like you're breathing in, you count 1, 2, 3, as long as you can. For as long, you can stretch it for as long as you can. The out breath should be a bit longer than the in breath. So basically the technique is, if you're counting 15 for when you're inhaling, it should be 16 or 17 when you're exhaling, right? As you breathe, feel your heart pounding. Keep doing this for a few minutes until you feel calm. If your thoughts dwell on anger, let it go and fight to replace the anger with gratitude that you're okay, right? So if you're feeling angry at a particular point of time, you need to be grateful that you're still okay despite whatever happened. Yeah.
That's easier said than done.
But that's the way of dealing with it. It's a healthy way of dealing with it. I mean, see, if you're constantly, everyone wants to be happy, right? But you're constantly wanting something new in your life. How are you going to be happy? Because there'll be lots of things which you can't purchase or you can't achieve.
Unlimited amounts.
Yeah, that's you're always going to be wanting something new. But if you change that around and say, okay, I'm grateful for whatever I have right now. Okay, if something if I get something more, I'll be even more grateful. But that's not necessary for my happiness. What I have now is good enough. Then you'll be happy. But if you keep striving for something which you can't achieve and or which is never going to come into your grasp, you're going to be unhappy for the rest of your life, because that's something you're always going to crave about, right? Notice how tense your neck, jaw and shoulders are. Release that tension. Keep breathing until you feel calm. Open your eyes, get up and enjoy your day. So it's a process. Those are steps that you need to take. Physically, you need to eat right and exercise. You need to take care of your body. Relaxation exercises are very important. Make time for yourself. Spend time on hobbies, getting fresh air, take a walk, spend time with your friends. No one can do everything, so ask for help from others when you feel you have taken on too many responsibilities. Don't try to put everything on yourself, and change your attitude. Focus on the positive and things for which you're grateful. Like I said earlier, you need to focus on the things that you're grateful for rather than what you can't have.
That also is important. You should not take more assignments.
Yeah, absolutely. You shouldn't pressure yourself into doing more. Just because you want to feel good, because everyone will think, okay, this person is so nice, doing everything for everyone else. It's not possible. You can only do what you're capable of doing, right? I mean, so there are some natural remedies for anxiety also. So when you're suffering from anxiety on a regular basis, then the deficiencies are basically in magnesium, vitamin D, zinc, vitamin B6, vitamin B9 and vitamin B12, right? So those supplements can help you. If it can help combat anxiety. So you can have grass-fed gelatin, 1 to 2 tablespoons per day, catnip tincture, 1 to 3 the dropper full per day, hemp seed oil, which is illegal in India, so I don't think you can have that, magnesium lotion, which is 1/2 to 1 teaspoon, and probiotics, 1 dose. Foods that you can eat, you can add to your cooking, like cinnamon, turmeric, ginger, garlic, raw honey, fruits and vegetables, Yeah, fruits and vegetables, grass-fed meats, eggs, bone broth and stock, coconut oil, and olive oil. Grass-fed meats. Meat, yeah. Yeah, actually.
Avoid. Sugar.
Foods to avoid, sugar, refined sugar basically. Yeah. Refined grains, vegetable oil, soy, artificial colors and flavors and sweeteners, preservatives, whole grains, processed foods of any kind.
Processed beverages?
Everything, any processed food has to be.
Yeah. I mean, whole grains.
Whole grains for some people. Not for everyone.
Subjective,
yeah.
What is the last one?
Processed foods of any kind. Yeah. All processed food, aerated beverages.
Ready to eat that.
Yeah. Yeah, and chemicals. Lots of chemicals, yeah. Effects, yeah. Yeah. So, the key to healing yourself is to show yourself compassion. Right?
Yeah.
Remember that you're doing the best you can at that particular moment. Talk to yourself like you would to a child when you make a mistake. Call a supportive friend or a family member. Tell yourself that you are loved. Drink something warm and comforting. Spend time with kind people.
Cappuccino.
Yeah. That's not kind people.
Warm,
yeah. So, 10 mindfulness tips that you can use. If you're listening, listen. If you're speaking, speak. If you're cooking, cook. Don't try to do too many things at the same time. But if you're doing one thing, just do it. Conclude that and then move on to the next.
Don't divert your mind.
Don't divert, yeah. If you're eating, eat. Pardon? Multitasking to be avoided, absolutely. Multitasking is not healthy.
Yeah.
If you're shitting, shit. If you're praying, pray. If you're watching, watch. If you're walking, I won't use that word. If you're walking, walk. If you're breathing, breathe. 12 steps for self-care. If it feels wrong, don't do it. Say exactly what you mean. Don't be a people pleaser.
Don't be a psychophant.
Yeah. Trust your instincts. Never speak bad about yourself. See, you know that you're doing wrong. You don't need to keep saying that you're doing wrong. Because the more you say it, you're pulling yourself. No, you're not. It's not about revealing. You're pulling yourself down. You're in your mind, you're telling yourself that you're not worth it.
You're not ready for this.
Yeah. So you need to, you accept that you're doing wrong. There's nothing wrong in accepting that you do it. If you have to apologize to someone, do it. But don't keep saying it. Because when you keep saying it, you're psychologically pulling yourself down.
I'm not liable for it.
Yeah. Never give up on your dreams. Don't be afraid to say no. Don't be afraid to say yes either. Be kind to yourself. Let go of what you can't control. Stay away from drama and negativity. And obviously love yourself and others. Overcome fear and anxieties. Toddlers need to talk about their... So when we talk about small kids, they need to talk about the fear in a safe way. If a toddler is scared of dogs, the adult might talk about dogs, then later read the child a book about the dogs. Then after some more time, the child might stand close to a friendly dog. So basically, that's a way of getting the child to be friendly with a... Yeah, to take care of the fear of that particular stimuli. So, you need to praise that child as you go along the way, right? As for each step that happens, the child needs to be praised so that he gets encouraged to? To overcome the fear, yeah, absolutely. But a lot of times we tend to play onto those fears and we say, okay, if you don't, because the parents don't want dogs in the house, so if the child is scared of dogs, they're happy because then the child will not ask them to have a dog. Yeah, it suits them. So that's the wrong method of handling situations like that. Twenty things to start doing. Drink a lot of water and green tea. Eat a big breakfast, average lunch, and a tiny dinner. Eat fruits and vegetables and natural foods. Go for a walk, swim, bike ride. Read a book or any number of them. go to bed early, stop thinking negative thoughts about yourself or others, don't dwell on the past, enjoy life's little things, do not judge or compare yourself with others, do not put things off, avoid processed food, again the same, stretch daily to increase flexibility. So, the exercise is important. Listen to peaceful music. A lot of people love listening to music because that calms them down. Yeah, yeah. Live in a tidy space. I mean, it's also healthy mentally and physically for you to have a tidy space around you. Wear clothes that make you happy. I mean, clothes have some kind of psychological effect on you. Yeah. Yeah. No, and you feel good about it. If you know, if you wear, sometimes what happens is when you feel depressed, you tend to choose colors which suit that kind of, see, that's again the fight and flight response. So if you're in that flight response, you choose colors which pull you down, and if you're in the fight response, yeah, you use colors which lift you, like the bright colors that can, yeah. So that fight and flight response is inherent in every reaction of ours. Throw away things that you don't need. Remember that all the efforts you're making now will pay in the end. So whatever you're doing, even if you don't get immediate results, you will get results at some point
in the long run.
So keep that hope going. Go outside also. I mean, experience the outside, the freshness of the air outside. Don't only stick around at home or within comfortable spaces because you're too scared to get out, right? No passion so effectually robs the mind of all its powers of acting and reasoning as fear. Edmund Burke. 6 ways to reason away anxious thoughts. Identify the anxiety. When we take time to just be with our anxiety without judging it, we begin to identify what specifically it is that is causing it, right? Break anxiety apart, break it into manageable bits. Ask yourself as many questions as you can about your anxiety. Consider what can be done. Brainstorm as many problem-solving ideas as you can. So, you're basically breaking it down to simple, resolvable matters, right? Determine if you actually want to do something. The choice not to act is still a decision and is still a form of action and control. As long as you have the choice, it's comforting, right? If you think you don't have a choice, then it becomes a problem. Decide to take action or not. Either decision to act or not is fine. It is knowing what you want that will help you determine a course of action. Be at peace with your decision. One of anxiety's common tricks is to make us second guess ourselves. When this happens, return to step one. So it's a cyclical pattern that you need to follow. Courage has to do with controlling fear, and it seems to me that focus has a way of overcoming anxiety. Tommy Franks. Bravery is the capacity to perform properly even when scared half to death. Omar Bradley. The reason people find it so hard to be happy is that they always see the past better than it was and the present worse than it is. Right? I mean, we always have a very rose-tinted view of the past. And the present is always much worse than what it actually is. So basically, we are following the same thing. I mean, what they're saying is the same thing what we've done before. Pause and take 5 deep breaths, expanding on the in-breath and slowing the out-breath. Observe life moments, moment to moment, and notice storylines you're creating in your mind. Notice what's happening instead of completely identifying with it. So basically, separate yourself from the anxious moment and try and notice what's happening. Practice mindfulness on others or just be with others. This lets you see the most people feel anxious to some degree. And it's not just a personal pathology. So it's not only you who is feeling anxious. Everyone feels anxious at some point or the other. Just understand that it's happening and separate yourself from that anxious thought. So basically, you need to be happy, you need to show gratitude, you need to show kindness, and you need people around you. Yeah, that is what will make you happy. Exercise, the right attitude, the proper insight, setting of goals, and the flow of messages within your brain. Every breath I inhale calms me, and every breath I exhale takes away tension. Breathe out slowly when you exhale. Make your exhalations longer than your inhalations. So meet your happy chemicals, dopamine, endorphins, oxytocins, and serotonin. Yeah. So these are the chemicals that will really make you happy.
Happy hormones.
Yeah. So they are the ones that you need to generate in your brain. And everything that we spoke about before is what you need to do to get those, get to that point where you can generate more of these chemicals. Endorphins, oxytocins. I will breathe, worry will not control me, stress will not break me. Okay? And you need to change your mindset. So, what is mindset? A set of beliefs or a way of thinking that determines one's behavior, outlook, and mental attitude. We've done this before, the mindset thing, so I won't repeat that. So, we'll end over here. Any questions?
I have a question. Panic.